All right, Mayor, folks are joining now.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Woody Washam and I'm Mayor Cornelius. Thank you so much for joining probably our most unusual coffee chat. As many of you know, we typically have meetings which typically draw 100, 125 people or something like that at Harvey's. And thank you, Charlie Dyer, for always supporting us there. But we couldn't do that this time because of the times we're in. So here we are with our first Zoom coffee chat. I hope you have your cup of coffee ready. I have mine right here. And I'll have to owe you a cup of coffee. Hopefully by next month, with a little luck, we'll be back to normal. But time will tell, and we will see. I did not want to cancel this particular coffee chat because it's critical right now that we talk, your government officials talk to all the citizens and tell you what we know and communicate with you. We've got a great group of panelists today that have agreed to do just that. I don't know that we'll have all of your answers. We'll address as many as we can. You'll notice on your screen that there is a particular way that we need you to ask questions just to control the flow of those questions. They will go directly to our communications director here in Cornelius, Danny Flynn. Danny's doing a great job for us. As you see on the screen, you can email townofcornelius@cornelius.org or text 704-237-7556. And Danny will be receiving those questions. And at the end of the presentations, she will be providing those back to the appropriate person that is actually asked the question or the most appropriate person to answer the question. So with that, I don't want to take up too much time. We do have our commissioners on the line as well in Cornelius, and that would include Commissioner Dennis Bilodeau, Dr. Mike Miltick, Commissioner Jim Duke, Commissioner Thurman Ross, and Commissioner Tricia Sisson. So thank you, commissioners, for joining us. We have a board meeting tonight at 7 o'clock. Any of you interested in that can rejoin by an appropriate Zoom link, which you will find out and about. Danny will be resending those out here later. So we do have two Zoom conferences at the town today, this being our first. So with that, I'd first like to start out with our U.S. Senator, Senator Tom Tillis. Tom is in his first term as Senator representing our town, our state. What I want to make sure you know is that Tom got his roots in his political roots, if you will, right here in Cornelius, starting out as a commissioner many years ago. We've come a long way, haven't we, Tom? And I just wanted to give you this opportunity to give us an update on the federal level. There's a lot kicking off at the federal level. I know I'm a banker, and we're starting the many, many wonderful stimulus loan processes today. Actually, I've got another conference call going on the side where training is happening to us bankers as to how to do that. So lots of good things happening from the federal level in the midst of all the concerns and the growing numbers in this coronavirus challenge that we have going on right now. So Senator Tillis, if you'll start out and give us an update, I really would appreciate that, sir.
Well, thank you, Woody, and to all the commissioners. I've got a call in about 25 minutes where we're getting back together over the weekend. We've been working with the administration on making sure that the guidance that came out from the Treasury last week, we've had a lot of businesses apply for loans already. There's some concern as to whether or not we're going to have resources on the back end to cover the subscription rate. I think that we'll be able to deal with that. Secretary Mnuchin has some flexibility, and then we can always provide an additional authorization from Congress if it's necessary. We're also seeing a big take rate on people applying for unemployment. One thing I would suggest you do if you're trying to apply for unemployment or people are calling you for advice, make sure they're going on the state website, the unemployment, to apply for unemployment. They can call the number, but they've been swamped. They typically process about 3,000 requests a week, and they've had over 350,000. I'm sure that number's higher now. I'll get the week or the overnight numbers sometime later this morning. So they're having a 100-fold increase in calls, and they've added about 300 people to help them process it, but it's going to take a while to draw it down. When they do get it, we've got the business loans, Woody, that you were talking about. We also have plussed up the unemployment benefit, $600 a week for people who qualify for unemployment. And then we have the other supplemental resources, the $1,200 per adult, $500 per child, that will start going out and posting to people's accounts, I'd say over the next 2 weeks. They're going to do that for anybody on Social Security, anybody that's filed their tax returns in 2018, 2019 will automatically get it. What we're trying to do now is get people who are not on Social Security or Social Security disability benefits or who haven't filed either in 2018 or 2019, trying to get them to go to the IRS website, that's irs.gov, so that they can also be put on radar and we can get the resources to them either through an automated deposit or if they haven't filed their taxes, they'll most likely get it in the form of a check or a card, depending upon whether or not Treasury can get a card system in place, a kind of a debit card versus sending a manual check, which we're trying to avoid because we don't want people to have to go out and cash them and have that social interaction. The only other thing, Woody, I'd mention, and I'll be on the call for as long as I can to answer any questions, but just really encouraging the social distancing. Stay at home if you can. My granddaughter lives over in Cornelius, 4.5 miles from me. I haven't seen her for almost a month except on Zoom video, family video chats that we've done. And I really encourage everybody to do that. And now that the federal guidance says if you go out, wear a mask, please do, even if you have to make one, particularly the elected officials, as awkward as it may feel. We got to lead by example, and hopefully everybody, if they are having to get out, they're doing it in that way. But Woody, I'm happy to answer any questions. I think most of y'all have seen the latest numbers on virus incidents. I think that we could be within the 2 to 4 week period to see a peak in certain parts of the country. Whether or not we'll see that in North Carolina yet, I'm not sure, because we're on the backside, or we started later. Our first reported case was just a little over a month ago on March the 3rd. So we've just got to make sure we do a better job here in North Carolina to make that peak as low as it can be and then flatten it so the hospitals still have the capacity to treat those. I don't know if you all, but I already know of two people that I knew pretty well who passed away as a result of the virus, one here in North Carolina, another one out of state. We've got to take this seriously and really step up as leaders to make sure everybody's heeding the advice on social distancing. So with that, Woody, I'll pass it back over to you, and I'll go on mute and be happy to answer any questions if they're directed my way.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Senator, and appreciate you staying as long as you can, and appreciate your presentation today, and also appreciate all you're doing in D.C. for us. Now I'm going to turn to our state level. And I'm going to call on, I think Senator Marcus and Representative Clark are going to sort of tag team. I'm going to start with Senator Marcus, if you'll update us from the state level, and Representative Clark, you can join in with that as well. Thank you. Thank y'all for being here. We appreciate it.
You need to unmute Senator Marcus.
Okay, I had to click it 3 times. I don't know what that was.
Well, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I appreciate Woody Washam offering to have me join with you this morning. It's my first early meeting in a long time. I think that's one of the silver linings for me in this new way of the world, is that there haven't been as many early meetings. So I appreciated that, I gotta say. I am Natasha Marcus, for anyone who's on the line who I haven't met. If you live in Cornelius, I represent you in the North Carolina Senate. I also represent Davidson, Huntersville, and parts of Charlotte. And I want to, at the top here, give you my email address, and I do respond to email addresses or email messages myself. So you can always reach me at my Senate office, which is natasha.marcus@ncledge.net. That's NCLEG.net. So if you have any questions after this presentation that we didn't get to answer, please feel free to reach out by email. So as far as the state level response to this pandemic, we have been technically out of session since COVID hit, not planned to go back into session until April 28th. That does not mean we're not working. And certainly, as you know, the governor has been working very hard using his emergency powers to do some very important things quickly without the need for legislative approval. So the stay-at-home order became a statewide order, Mecklenburg County leading in North Carolina to do it first, a little bit before we had a statewide order, but now a statewide order. So important, I will reiterate what Senator Tillis said, which is we really, really need your cooperation on that. It's our best line of defense. We don't have enough tests to test everyone and know who's carrying this virus and who is not. So the only thing we can do is to stay at home. So please do that. The governor's order also made unemployment insurance much more available by eliminating the 1 week wait time. So I want to make sure people know that anyone who has lost their job or had hours reduced is eligible right away. You don't have to wait a week as you normally would have had to, and you don't have to prove that you're looking for another job. The governor's understands that most of the employers who are laying workers off right now want to hire you back as soon as we can get back up in business. And there aren't a lot of other jobs out there to look for right now. And plus, we don't want people looking for going store to store looking for your jobs right now. We need you to stay home. And another important part of that was that employers do not have to pay the cost of their employees receiving unemployment benefits. So there's no reason why employers shouldn't be encouraging their laid off workers to go ahead and apply as soon as possible for that. Also, the governor has forbidden utility service cutoffs. So that's really important that people will be able to stay in their homes and have power and have water and not need to leave. And then he's working very hard to find the resources that we need for healthcare. So we don't have enough masks. We don't have enough ventilators. It looks like they're not coming from the national stockpile. So we are working as a state as hard as we can to find those resources for the people of North Carolina. If you can help in that way, if you have connections to suppliers, please let us know, let me know, or let Representative Clark know, and we can pass that information on to DHHS. And now that we have federal bill.
Senator, can I interrupt you just one second, please? I think we're having some technical difficulties out in Zoom land. Let me tell Danny that, and we can hopefully get that corrected. But it appears that some of the folks can't access on Facebook. So Danny, if you could clear that up for us, I would greatly appreciate that. I've gotten several texts in that regard. Or give them some instructions. If you'll post that out on the town Facebook page and tag me, I'm getting the messages. So I'm sorry, Senator. I'll let you go ahead now. I'm sorry.
Well, if people can't hear me, there's no point in talking. Maybe that's I should right. just wait.
That's
I don't.
That's right. We're all learning here, aren't we?
Yeah. Do we give a few? Everybody that's already on can hear you. We've got about 45 people that are on that did access it successfully. The other folks, I think, maybe are new to Zoom. So we'll send them a little bit more information, but yeah, you can keep going and I'll.
Yeah, I've had a few texts from people saying they need a meeting ID or they can't seem to get in. So
I'm gonna try to get them all settled here.
So do you think should we continue then, even though they're not able to access right now?
Yes, we have many people already on. So
okay. All right. Well, I'll keep going. I was starting to mention now we have a federal bill. Senator Tillis mentioned we have it's a massive bill and it's going to help North Carolina a lot. And so our job as state legislators will be figuring out what the federal government is going to cover, what they're going to require the state to match in order to draw down federal funds, and then to find out what holes they have left that the state funds are going to have to fill. State funds are going to be tricky now because we're putting off collections, and obviously our state's economy has taken a huge hit. But one of the big things that we need to do as a state is to change the way Department of Employment Security is set up, because right now, if you are a self-employed worker in North Carolina, you do not qualify for unemployment benefits. That's the way it's always been in North Carolina, but that's a problem because we have so many unemployed people who were running their own business or working a gig economy, self-employed people. And so the federal package has made it so that we can include those people, but our system is not set up to do that yet. So that's a big hurdle we have to clear. We have some other jobs we need to fix that the, as you probably know, income taxes were supposed to be due on April 15th. Federal and state. The state automatically changes the date when the federal's date changes. So our date has changed. It's no, you don't need to file until July 15 now. But unless the legislature meets and waives it, there was going to be interest due on late payments, anything paid after April 15th. So obviously that's a problem. And people feel like, well, that's unfair. What am I supposed to do with that? So the legislature needs to meet, I hope, and expect that we would have bipartisan support to put off the interest as well. But unless we meet and do that, there's going to be that problem. And I would hope we will meet and do that retroactively so that people aren't feeling like they have to pay interest on a payment that's supposed to be deferred. We're also I'm on a Senate work group that's looking into how we're going to run our election in November when we may have still active COVID cases and need to be social distancing. And what does that look like? And can we encourage more people in North Carolina to use mail-in ballots, which would keep people healthier? We're worried we're not going to have enough poll workers to run the election the way we need to run it. So that's one of the things we're looking at. And then I'm hoping we can, I know a lot of people are going to lose their health care when they've lost their job. And this is a time that to me makes it very clear that everybody should have available and affordable health care. And so we're looking at hoping that we can get some bipartisan support for more expanded and more accessible, affordable health care for everyone in North Carolina through either opening the ACA marketplace, expanding Medicaid, or whatever other options my Republican counterparts would like to pursue, because I think that's important. That's a little bit of a summary of what we're doing and what's ahead. I'd like to mention that I have a document that I share on my Facebook page. It's a question and answer document that I update. I just updated it this morning with new information. It's available on my Facebook page. Please go there if you have questions that are COVID related. We can help, as can Representative Clark's office, with your unemployment claims if you're having trouble getting through, and many people are, I'm sorry to say, they're flooded. We're working on education funding. I'm sure Rhonda Cheek will talk about the funding issue that just came up, but I want to say, again, I'll say my email again, it's natasha.marcus@ncledge.net. Please email me if I can help you, if you have questions. You can sign up for our newsletter. I'm sending out those about once a week with updates and information and links that are helpful. And then also my Facebook page is available with daily information. So thank you all for the opportunity to speak to you. I'm sorry we're going through this. We need your help, though. Stay at home. Stay away from other people. And do the best you can to try to find silver linings here as we move through this. So thank you. I'll turn it over to whoever's next.
Thank you, Senator. We'll go next to Representative Clark. What would you add to that in terms of the from the state level, Representative? And then we'll turn a little bit more locally to the county and school system and town after that. So continue.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. This is Representative Christy Clark. I represent you in Huntersville, Cornelius, and Davidson. Senator Marcus covered almost all the things we're working on, except for that in the House of Representatives, Speaker Moore has created some select committees to work on issues around elections, unemployment, operations of the state, education, healthcare. Those meetings are going on right now. And if you want to listen into those, you can go to ncledge.gov and get the information to listen to those meetings as they're going on there. I know most of the emails that I've received from constituents relate to difficulties filing your unemployment claim. I know this is something that is extremely stressful for everyone. And so I want to remind everyone to stay patient. Our DES was not expecting this large number. It was not something they were prepared for. As Senator Tillis mentioned, they were getting about 3,000 claims a week. It's gone up to approximately 370,000 so far. But they are hiring new staff. They're adding about 150 people to their actual staff. They're bringing on a 200-person call center, and the initial steps of the call center will be to help your employer get their PIN number so they can approve your request for unemployment. And so that's where some of the delay is happening. And then they're also getting, of course, new servers and computers and things like that to help them with this. So that's a pretty big deal. The other thing I've been getting a lot of emails about is the DMV. What's going to happen with paying if you have to renew your tags and things like that? What's going to happen with that? Those fees are statutory, and so they require the General Assembly to change the ability to waive them or change them as they go on. So that's something that's on our list of things to do when we go back in April, which is now, the end of this month, hopefully. The other thing I've been hearing a lot about is our notaries and court reporters, and what can you do about notarizing in person. That too is a statutory issue. And so I'm a notary, so I've been notarizing in person. I have a hand sanitizer, and I hand sanitize my pen and my table and everything when I'm, and my stamp, and try to get it done. So that's what Secretary Marshall has recommended for notaries. So we have to change that at the statutory level too, which I think we will end up having to do that too. And then of course, court proceedings have been delayed until June 2nd. So if you have something going on in court, be sure and check with either your attorney or the court system about those things. And finally, just to reiterate what everyone has been saying is please stay home. Only go out if it's something for essential business or survival. So that means your medications, groceries, or urgent or necessary healthcare appointments. Other than that, just stay home. I know it's not a lot of fun. I've been walking around my neighborhood and waving afar from my neighbors to like get out of my house. And I think that's something great to do. So just do that as well. You can stay in touch with me at my legislative email, which is christy.clark@nclege.net. And you can sign up for my newsletter by texting Christy C to 22828. And my newsletter I put out every Friday, and I update it with all the information and resources that have been added to us, given to us as legislators throughout the week. And so it is a great place to go, and I have all the links and phone numbers that you might need if you need food assistance, childcare, get in touch with DES or the SBA loans or anything of that nature. So I'll let everybody go on.
Thank you, Representative Clark. We appreciate you being with us today. Now, let's take it to Mecklenburg County, one of the epicenters. Unfortunately, Commissioner Dunlap, George Dunlap is chairman of the Mecklenburg County Board of Commissioners. He's a friend of mine and does a great job for us throughout our county. And thank you for being here. And if you'll give us a little county updates, a lot's going on in Mecklenburg County. Thank you, George. And you're on mute.
Okay.
There you go. You're okay. Good.
Well, first of all, let me say good morning to everybody, and to thank you for providing the opportunity for me to come on the program and provide an update. Of course, I'm not as good as Dina. I am filling in for her. She's attending a very important meeting this morning relative to the field hospital that we've been asked to establish, which will be established up at UNC Charlotte on its campus. So that is one of the things that we're that she's working on, which is why she couldn't attend the meeting this morning. Let me start off this morning by reiterating some of the things that have already been stated. The importance of washing your hands, the importance of social distancing, the importance of following the stay-at-home order. I've actually been disturbed by some of the things that I've seen relative to the stay-at-home order. I'm learning that one of the reasons we have so many community spread cases of the virus is because people are not following the order. And it is unfortunate and sad to say that one of the biggest violators of that stay-at-home order is the church. I've got two calls this week. One where church member reported their pastor because they believe that the pastor has the virus. Several members in the congregation have come down with the virus. In fact, the person who called me because they had been quarantined for 11 days already, and the pastor was planning on having service again on last evening. I didn't get a report yet as to whether or not law enforcement or some enforcement measure were taking place. Then I also heard about another congregation where about 15 members of the choir contracted the virus. They believe that they contracted the virus because they had all gone on a cruise prior to being on the choir stand. But and a number of those persons are now hospitalized as a result of being on that cruise or contacting the virus. So I want to emphasize the importance of the stay-at-home order and following some of the hygiene rules that have been suggested. Of course, some of us are now hearing that it is also being suggested that we wear a covering, a mask of some sort when we're outside. While Mecklenburg County doesn't require that, I think it's a good rule to follow, better safe than sorry. So what I would advise people to do that as well. I want to talk just a little bit about some of the things that are available to Mecklenburg County residents, in particular, those persons who are business owners. At our meeting on tomorrow, we expect to pass two resolutions. One for small business owners, those business owners who own businesses of 50 or less, will establish a $5 million fund, a stabilization fund that they will have access to help stabilize their business. Also, a micro lending stabilization fund for micro businesses where they can access funds. And if they continue to employ their workers, then they will not have to pay those funds back. But you'll hear more about those things after our doing our meeting tomorrow night. So if you're a small business owner, I want to make sure that you pay attention to our meeting tomorrow night to see how you can access those funds. I also wanted to make sure that people understood that when Mecklenburg County does something of this sort, it is for all of Mecklenburg County. So the towns of Cornelius and Huntersville and Matthews and Midhill and Davidson and Pineville are all entitled to the same offerings that we offer to the residents of the city of Charlotte. I also wanted to kind of update you on the latest in terms of the numbers of cases in Mecklenburg County. You've heard that we are 1/3 of the state of North Carolina. The last report I got, and this number moves quite frequently, was that there were 665 cases, 6 deaths attributed to the coronavirus at this time. Let's see if there's anything else. Oh, and yes, we talk about being the epic center of the state of North Carolina, and when we can anticipate that we will have our surge. The latest report I got that our surge will occur somewhere between the middle of April and the middle of May. We're behind New York, as you heard Senator Tillis say. So that means that we're going to have our surge a little bit later than some of the other towns that are the other cities that reported the virus a lot sooner than we did. I apologize for that. Can't stop my phone from ringing. I guess I could turn it off. So I wanted people to be aware of that. And again, I want to thank all of the towns for being in support of us signing the stay-at-home order. We were fortunate enough to get everybody to cooperate with that. And I think now people will look back and see the wisdom on our doing that. And I can't say how much I appreciate working with the town mayors and the city mayor and getting that stay-at-home order in place. And I think that's about all, unless you have some questions.
Yeah, we'll be back to the question, George, and thank you so much. That was a great update. We appreciate that. Along with the county, our representative for Charlotte-Mecklenburg Schools is Rhonda Cheek. Rhonda, are you out there? I know she had a phone call.
I am here.
Okay, she is here. Thank you, Rhonda. If you'll give us a quick update from the school system. Appreciate you being here.
Great, thank you so much. Surprisingly, we are still in business, even though our students are learning at home remotely right now. We are feeding between 22 and 27,000 meals a day through our food service to make sure that our nutritionally fragile students are still getting what they need. Even though we're out, we've actually started a collection for 1,000 cloth face masks so that our nutrition team can all be wearing the masks that are being recommended now by the CDC. And I'm going to show you, I don't know if you can see me, but I have mine. And I'm wearing mine whenever I'm out in public. I have been for about a week because I anticipated this as a healthcare provider as well, that I needed to be wearing one when I was out in public places. So the biggest thing today is actually the kickoff for remote learning for our youngest children. Up until now, it's been supplemental and just kind of working out the bugs of technology. We are super excited in Mecklenburg County to have the level of technology and one-to-one computer access and Wi-Fi access for so many. Surprisingly, I found out last week, we still have a couple thousand students we haven't been able to reach since school got out on March the 13th. For whatever reason, we do know that a lot of our students are families of healthcare providers, and some of them have been sent out of state to go stay at relatives while their parents are taking care of our ill residents. The other thing that Senator Marcus mentioned is the state school board approved a emergency financial package for all schools, which would have been great, except for there's out of all the counties in North Carolina, which I believe there's 100, if I'm not mistaken. Mecklenburg County was the only county left off of that emergency relief fund. It was considered a low income fund. And although Mecklenburg County serves more students of poverty than any district in the state, because our overall poverty level didn't meet their hurdles, they absolutely just left us off of all the funding for this emergency relief package. So we're asking people to reach out to the State Board of Education, chaired by Eric Davis here in Mecklenburg County, and let them know that Mecklenburg should not be left out. We need to service our students. We're taking care of them, regardless of the fact that the State Board of Education made a ridiculous decision on last week. So that's about it. We are just trying to keep things moving forward and be optimistic. We realize that every day that goes by, the chances of us returning to school this year are growing slimmer, and we're just going to do our best by every student to try to do everything we can. We've got amazing teachers right now that are putting in a lot of work to make sure that they can keep their students advancing and learning, and we just hope that people do find the silver lining in this. I'm a parent of a high school senior. I was told that his year is pretty much done on March the 13th, and we're looking for silver linings in all that we do right now. This extra time has given us time to work on some other things. So I just encourage parents to find the silver lining in this new way of learning that we're in right now. But I thank you for having me on this morning.
Thank you so much, Rhonda. We really appreciate your being here, and we appreciate that update and all the good things that are going on with CMS in spite of our challenges. Next, I want to call on our town manager. Andrew Grant has been working 24/7 almost in staying on top of issues and matters related to our town as it's connected to this emergency situation that we're in. He does a good job in keeping me up to date as well as our board. And so, Andrew, what updates do you have for us today?
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, panel, for being here today and all the attendees. So just want to discuss about what the town is doing relative to this crisis and a little bit of history, how we got here. And when I say we, Mecklenburg County, as we're all aware, second week of March, we had our first confirmed Mecklenburg County case. Shortly thereafter, we saw a community spread. The Mecklenburg County state of emergency was adopted March 13th. The Mecklenburg County stay-at-home order was adopted that Chair Dunlap referred to on March 26th. On March 30th, North Carolina adopted the statewide stay-at-home order. It did allow for more restrictive orders, local orders, to be in effect and have precedence. And it also did another good thing by allowing or restricting mass gatherings to no more than 10 individuals. As Chair Dunlap mentioned, as of last night, we had the county had 665 confirmed cases, unfortunately, six deaths. Since early March, the governments of your governments in Mecklenburg County, the county, the city of Charlotte, all six towns, including Cornelius, have been working around the clock to address the COVID-19 crises again in our county. As the mayor alluded to, and also Chair Dunlap has alluded to, there's a tremendous amount of coordination within the county. Every day, and we've been doing this for a few weeks now, and we'll continue to do it until this is over. Your town manager, myself, the other town managers in the county, county manager, Dina DiOrio, the city manager, the county health director, Mecklenburg County emergency management officials, representatives from Atrium, Novant, and a long list of other individuals. We have a call every day. And again, the purpose of that is to manage, mitigate, coordinate, and plan efforts and resources for our county. Just want to mention real quick, in case there are questions, if there are questions about interpreting the order that's in effect, there is a helpline, and that's 704-353-1926, 704-353-1926, and they're open 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Friday. If you have concerns about noncompliance with the order, please call 311, that's 311 to report. And if you're interested in volunteering, because we have a lot of gracious individuals and organizations interested in volunteering and also providing donations for relief effort, please go to CHARMEC, C-H-A-R-M-E-C-K, responds.org. And that's CHARMEC, responds, all one word, .org. As the mayor mentioned, our board meetings are now virtual. Please feel free to log in. We do accept public comments via email. You can email those public comments to townofcornelius@cornelius.org, townofcornelius.cornelius.org. And we will read those comments into the minutes. Relative to the departments and the services that we're providing, as all of our organizations, we are operating different now. However, I will say, you know, back to the board meetings, we conducted our first ever budget workshop. Normally it's a two-day session, and we did that over 3 days, town staff and town board, because we still have a tremendous amount of work to do, even while this crisis is going on. Police and fire remain ready and able to serve. On our pet adoptions, we have an animal shelter, as a lot of you know. We are taking adoption appointments for that service, and we continue to adopt out animals, but we do it safely. Other updates, our parks department remains very active. Our parks and greenways do remain open. We want you to enjoy them, but however, we also encourage and are required, everyone's required to have physical distancing and social distancing in effect when you visit our parks. We have closed our playgrounds. We have closed our restrooms. The courts, such as volleyball courts and basketball courts, tennis courts, are open and available, not for group play, but for singles play. We don't want sharing of equipment beyond beyond a single household. And also with our park department, again, in the vein of operating differently, We have a weekly online newsletter that comes out with a lot of activities throughout the week, so please look for that. Couple other things. Our Public Works crew, give them a lot of kudos. Our solid waste provider, a couple weeks ago, notified the town that they were going to stop providing yard waste collection. We've started an internal in-house yard waste collection with our existing solid waste, Public Works crew. We don't have as many resources as Republic has, our solid waste provider. However, we are providing that service, and we will come pick up and try to pick up on your normal collection day. However, we do ask that you follow the same requirements for size requirements as before. The one thing we cannot do is pick up anything that's bagged. Again, that's because of health concerns. The last thing I'll mention, Mayor, is that as all these expenses are occurring and that we're working on COVID-19, much like our sister organizations, we continue to track our costs. The finance department is very heavily involved in tracking our costs so that we can seek federal reimbursement for this. So, Mayor, thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate the update. I believe I have covered all levels of our updates. Thank you all for hanging in with us, and thank you for the great updates. I think that was very beneficial. Now, I believe it's time to turn to questions from the viewers today. So, Danny, can you help us with that, or do you have any further instructions? As you see on the screen, if you have a question, you may email it to townofcornelius@cornelius.org or text it to 704-237-7556. 704-237-7556.
Yes, this is Danny Flynn, and we did get several questions via text and email. Some of the questions were addressed already in the presentations, but we may just want to reiterate a few things. One of the questions that we have is, and this is for all panelists, is whether or not you feel that North Carolina has received sufficient resources from the federal government.
Okay, that's a state question. So I'm going to call on one of our state reps to address that, please.
Okay, I think I'm unmuted now. Can you hear me?
Yes, you are. You're good. Thanks.
That's a tricky thing. I think it has to be I do it and Danny does it, I think is what's happening. So sadly, my answer on that is no, we have not received sufficient supplies. I addressed that in my remarks. It is required that the governor, on behalf of our state, do all he can to find the PPE and ventilators that we know we are going to need. Our local hospitals have been working closely with the governor to find those resources. It's something that our governor's been very careful not to politicize and not to criticize from the federal government as much as possible, but it is in fact true that a lot of the work that our state has been doing to get ready for this surge of cases relates to the fact that unfortunately we've only received approximately 33% of what we've requested from the national stockpile. So we have to make up the difference, and that's what we're working on. We've never had enough tests, which is one of the reasons why we had to have a statewide stay-at-home order. It's the only thing we can do when we can't test people. We don't know if they're carrying the virus or not. So that's the next best thing. So we're doing all we can under some difficult circumstances.
I just want to add and reiterate, if you have any other resources where there might be gloves or masks, for example, I had a connection to Advance Auto Parts and they were able to use their supply chain to get gloves and masks to the state through NCDHHS, and those were just delivered last week. And so you wouldn't think about an auto parts company having gloves and masks, but they do, and they also have paper towels for that matter. And so if you have any connections to it, like paint or auto body or anything where people are using masks and gloves, please let us know. You can email us at our email addresses about those resources, and the NCDHHS will vet them and get in touch with them.
And Representative, we have found a resource actually in nearby Yadkinville that is manufacturing. It's an old textile company. It's been around for over 100 years that have stepped up to the call and are now manufacturing the non-surgical masks. So I'll be glad to provide that offline if anybody out there is interested in the mask. They get to you pretty quickly after you put your order in. So very, very important. Yes, next question, Danny.
Okay, so this question, we also on the phone, we have someone from emergency management, Hannah Sanborn, and this question, I think she's probably gonna be best suited to answer.
Okay, great.
So it's three questions, and I know one of them I don't think that she has the answer to, but the questions are, what is the status of the 3,000 beds in the Charlotte Field Hospital request? How many ICU beds in Charlotte and how many are available? And when will Charlotte NC hit the COVID-19 peak? And Hannah, if you, I've unmuted you, if you wanna unmute yourself and maybe just share that and any other updates from emergency management with us.
All right, can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, perfect. Thank you, Danny. So yeah, I am unable to answer the specific number of ICU beds, but what I can say is that the projection models that we received from the two healthcare systems does indicate that, if we have 30% social distancing in our community, then we are still going to be significantly short on a lot of resources. And so that is why the field hospital project is a primary concern. So the policy group that we work with meets very regularly, multiple times a day, and are in discussions to figure out that plan. So as those updates are available, we'll be pushing that out through the Joint Information Center that is co-located with the Emergency Operations Center. And then as far as the peak goes, again, it's variable, and I believe we had some discussion of that earlier, but with that 30% social distancing, the projected peak is May 11th. However, depending on how social distancing goes and how well that compliance goes, it could be anywhere from mid, late April to into mid May. So that does vary. I'm just going to reiterate, even though I know everyone here already has, that how important that stay-at-home order is and how important trying to find ways to comply with it is. Our Deputy Director of Emergency Management made the point on Friday during a press conference that when you're out in the community, if you think to yourself, do I have to be out right now? Am I out for something essential or can I be home? And really just thinking in those terms, because it is just so essential that we get as much compliance as possible.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Next question, Danny.
So we have quite a few questions about unemployment, how to apply, and there's some have applied and there's been no response quite yet. I know it's already been addressed, but perhaps we could just reiterate that and reiterate where folks can go to apply.
Yeah, you can go to, let me make sure I have it right. It's DES, I think it's .nc.gov to apply. And also one thing that I learned recently is when you apply, your employer has 10 days to respond to that application. And so that is one of the reasons why some people are still seeing theirs as pending, is if their employer has not responded to that. And then after the 10 days, if the employer has not responded, then DES will go ahead and process the claim and issue the unemployment from there. One of the holdups is, of course, the technology. Employers are having to get their PIN numbers because they had never had them before or didn't need them. And so that's one of the things the 200 person call center is gonna be doing, is helping employers get their PIN numbers. But it will take 14 days about from the time that you put in your request to the time that you first get a check. So that is something to be thinking about. It doesn't happen instantaneously. But if you have issues, please do email either of us, Senator Marcus or myself. We can help you from our side, because sometimes things just don't work right and technology fails, as we all know. So you can just email us.
Yes, and I will add to that. We're happy to help when we can. There is so many people, as Representative Clark mentioned, are having trouble getting their PIN number account set up, that there is a specific email that you can send, an email address that you can send your request to if you're an employer who's having an issue getting your PIN set up. And that is NCDES, so that's North Carolina Department of Employment Security, password help at ncommerce.com. NCDES password help at ncommerce.com. So if that's the holdup, if your employer is saying we can't get our PIN to reset and the website's not working, ask your employer, or if you are the employer, to use that email to get that PIN up and going. And also, there is a phone number. If you can't get through on the website, you can always try the phone number. As Representative Clark mentioned, they are hiring a lot more agents to try to be able to answer your calls. And that number is
888-737-0259. Go ahead, Dan.
I'm sorry, Mayor. We just have maybe time for just one more two-part question that we've gotten quite a bit. What if you're self-employed? And if you can give some insight around the small business loans and the delay with those being processed.
I meant to say that, so I'm glad someone asked it. If currently, as I tried to explain earlier, which when I think I was not fully broadcasting, is that currently in North Carolina, if you are self-employed or you do gig work, you're a independent contractor, any way you want to say that, you currently do not qualify for unemployment insurance. So if you apply now, you're going to get a response from DES saying that your claim is denied. But here's the good news. The federal package has expanded who can apply for unemployment to include you. So there's going to be some time between when that money has been appropriated at the federal level and when it's actually available here and when we in North Carolina can process that claim. So the best advice that I've gotten is you can go ahead and file your claims, get your account set up, request unemployment now as a self-employed person, knowing that your initial answer is going to be a denial. But at least then you'll have your account ready to go when the money from the federal government comes and when our system is updated to process self-employed people. There was a second part to that question, which I can't remember. Maybe I'll toss it to Representative Clark, so I'm not doing all the talking.
And one thing about your employment, if you initially are getting denied because you're a gig or self-employed, your unemployment will be retroactive to the date that you applied. So, or if there's a delay or anything like that in your application right now, you will get retroactive. It won't start on the day that you get the approval. The second question was on Small Business Administration, and there is a customer service center that you can call. It is 1-800-659-2955. And that would be the best way to get in touch to make sure that you are choosing the right loan to apply for and the right process. And if you need help with that, you know, again, just email us, but that would be the best place to start.
Thank you, Representative. Danny, are we out of time?
Oh, it's 9:30.
Yeah, it's 9:30.
Okay, I'm sure you have additional questions, and can we try to address those questions by email or text later? Is that possible?
Yes, if they want to, your question didn't get answered or you have additional questions, you can email them to that townofcornelius@cornelius.org email address, and we'll work with the panelists to get some answers for you.
Thank you so much. I hope this has been helpful to everybody. Panelists, do you have anything quick that you would like to add before we adjourn?
Stay home.
Stay home. There you go. And the thing I would add to that is please be responsible for your own actions during this time. You know, don't look for ways to get around the emergency order. Look for ways that you can comply with the emergency order. Now is the time. I went out, and I have to admit that for the first time yesterday, with my face mask on, it was a weird feeling. It really is. I encourage our electeds and folks that are panelists here to, as Senator Tillis, I think, said this, to set the example. It's okay to appear in the mask, even though you're a politician, and maybe that doesn't appear just right, but it's the right thing to do right now. Please be responsible for your own action. It's tough on these warm weekends on the lake. It continues to be tough. We're not in a military state. I know that, but folks have to be responsible or this will get delayed and delayed as far as the end of it. So we need to see this through and get on the other side. Let's come down the other side of the mountain as quickly as possible. And we've got to have cooperation to do that. This is serious business. I'm so regretful that we're all having to go through it, but it is what it is. And I just simply ask you to do your part. I thank you. Many, many folks are complying with the order to the nth degree. I know that. But when you're in our parks, when you're out and about, first of all, try not to do that. But if you have to, please comply with our emergency order here in Mecklenburg County, state of North Carolina, and at the national level as well. Thank you. Have a great day. If I can do anything for you as your mayor, please let me know. Thank you, panelists.
We have a couple of folks that wanted to say, the panelists that had something to say. I'm going to unmute everyone, all the panelists.
Panelists, go for it.
Okay.
I've been following a data screen that does state by state, the IHME data, and for some reason in the last 24 hours, the projections for North Carolina have markedly improved. For our social distancing is having an impact. We need to keep doing that. And I will also echo wash and distance. And by the way, I've worn a mask for most of my life.
Thank you, Doc. All right, anybody else have anything to add?
Okay. Just a couple of things, Woody. One of the things that I want to encourage people to do is to take care of their physical and mental health. You know, this is taxing on all of us. And I know how people feel being cooped up in the house. I'm fortunate in that I have my garden out back. I can go out and work in my garden and work on my yard. But I want to encourage people to take care of their physical and their mental health. And then I want to lastly leave two hotline numbers. And I know there are a lot of numbers, and I'm hoping that we can get one central number where people can call in and have it directed to wherever it needs to go. But unfortunately, at this time, we still have to give out these various hotline numbers. So if you have a public health issue, 980-314-9400. Again, 980-314-9400. And the hotline relative to questions related to the stay-at-home order. If you need some clarification or if something's not clear, 704-432-4187. Again, 704-432-4187. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Appreciate everybody today. There are lots of updates going on out there. Please stay in tune. Please stay informed. There's one particular one that happens three times a week. You can update yourself on that by going to LKN Election Connection. It's out there three times a week with some good panelists as well. But please keep yourself up to date as we work through this tough time. Again, have a good day and be safe. Thank you so much.